Hi, I'm Iain Portalupi, and today we're going to rebuild this classic vertical twin-cylinder air compressor pump. These pumps were made by the thousands by Campbell Hausfeld from the early 60s to the early 90s, and they were slapped on air compressors of every make and color you could possibly think of. Thousands of them were sold by Sears under their name. Campbell Hausfeld also sold them under their name. Speedaire, which is a Granger rebadge, sold them by the thousands. There's just a ton of these air compressors out there, and for good reason. They were super simple. They were very robust. They work really well. And by running them at different speeds, you can get more or less air out of it, depending on whether you belt this up to a 1-horsepower motor or a 2-horsepower motor. There's even a slightly bigger version of this for 3-horsepower motors. This pump, which is the most common size that goes on a 1-horsepower or 2-horsepower motor, has a 2 3/4-inch bore. So the cylinders are 2 3/4-inch in diameter. The pistons are 2 3/4-inch in diameter. Before we start rebuilding it, we do want to open up to make sure we know what size pistons they are. Because even though this came off a 1-horsepower air compressor, because these things look so similar on the outside, and because they've been around for so long, there are times when different pumps get swapped over to different compressors. So before we order parts for it, always want to open it up. Just make sure the insides are what you think they're going to be, because it'd be too bad to buy the wrong rebuild kit, have to send it back and get a different one. Other than the rebuild kit, standard tools will rebuild this whole thing. You really just need a ratchet set with a 3/4 or 3/8 drive ratchet and an assortment of sockets. The only specialty tool we're going to need is the cylinder hone, and these things are about $15 at an auto parts store. Cylinder hones come in 3 different sizes. This is the medium size one. You want to look on the package and make sure that its range of cylinder sizes, because it's spring loaded, can handle 2 3/4 inch, if that's what your compressor pump has. If it has the 3-inch size, then obviously you need to make sure that your cylinder hone will do that. Before you rush out and buy a cylinder hone, however, ask yourself, are you going to replace the rings in this thing? If you're not going to replace the rings in this thing, and the cylinder looks like it's in good shape, and all you want to do is just freshen it up a little bit, then you don't really need the cylinder hone. On this one, however, the piston rings were all seized up, so I needed new rings. The cylinders were rusted, so I needed to clean them up. So in this video, we're going to hone the cylinders. Just be aware, if you're not touching the piston rings or the cylinders, then obviously you don't need to go out and buy this. Speaking of rust in the cylinders, even though this is a very well-designed pump, very robust, it lasts a long time, there is one major design flaw in these things. And that design flaw is the fact that the air intake is on the top of this thing. Why they ever put it on top versus on the side, I will never know. But this single feature right here has done in a lot of pumps over the years, because for whatever reason, these things seem to migrate to the outdoors, and then they get rained on, and all that rainwater goes right in, right through the air filter, and fills up the cylinders, and it just sits there and rusts. This one was no exception. It spent some quality time outside. The cylinders were full of water. The crankcase was full of water. I'm frankly amazed it didn't split apart from freezing, but it didn't, and now we have a working one again. So if we can rebuild this one that was full of water, I'm confident you can rebuild your air compressor. The other thing I should point out is over its very long lifespan of production, it went through several changes. Some of them have a one-piece head. This one has a separate head and what I call a valve block that holds the reed valves. Some of the later ones actually had fins that weren't vertical like this, but went around the thing. As long as the crankcase has this basic shape to it in the front, and the cylinder block is removable, it's pretty much the exact same thing. And the nice thing about that is you can get a universal rebuild kit that comes with all the gaskets you need, regardless of the head style. You're going to get extra gaskets in it that you're not going to use because it comes with all the gaskets you could possibly need for one of these 2 3/4 inch bore pumps. So if your kit comes with stuff that you don't end up using, that's why it's like that. It's for all of these things. Same thing with the air cleaner. This one uses a one-piece rectangular felt air cleaner. The ones that have the one-piece head use 2 sponge rubber air cleaners. It comes with both styles of air cleaner, so that way you can use whichever one goes with your pump. The nice thing is, because of the sheer number of these things in existence still, you can get any part you want on this thing. You can even get replacement pistons and connecting rods. If yours needs a new piston or connecting rod, or 2 pistons and connecting rods, you can get that. Other things like the cylinder block, which is removable from the crankcase, they don't make those new anymore, but they do pop up on eBay from time to time. Although for the price of them on eBay, it's probably cheaper to buy a whole second pump and either rebuild that or use it for parts for the other one. But it is available. Same with the heads, same with the crankcase, same with the crankshaft. Everything is available. It uses standard bearings in the thing. We'll get to that when we replace one of the bearings. So super easy to work on, really hard to mess up. And once you rebuild this thing, it'll be good for another 30, 40 years if you do routine maintenance, like clean the air filter and change the oil. Off camera, I tore down the air compressor and I cleaned up the outside and cleaned up the inside. You want to make sure the thing is good and clean both on the outside and the inside before you start rebuilding it, because you don't want sludge and metal filings and grit that have accumulated after 50 plus years down in the oil sump to migrate into the bearings or get caught between the piston and the cylinder walls and undo all the work you just did. And you don't want years worth of garage grime that builds up on the outside to wind up on the inside as you're reassembling it, which again would speed up wear. So you want to clean the outside, want to clean the inside. I didn't show that for a couple reasons. One, cleaning things off is very boring. And it's even more boring to watch somebody else clean stuff off. So nobody wants to see that. So I did that off camera. Also, I didn't show the disassembly of this for 2 reasons. One, if you really want to know how to disassemble it, just watch the reassembly part of this video in reverse and do it that way. And 2, to be brutally honest, disassembling this thing is the easiest part of this rebuild. If you can't figure out how to take something apart, which is basically just remove all the bolts and parts fall off of it, and you keep removing the bolts until you run out of bolts to remove, and it gets to the point where you can't remove any more parts from it, that's pretty self-explanatory. If you can't do that, you probably aren't going to be able to successfully rebuild this thing and put it back together. So think of that as a rite of passage. If you can't take the air compressor apart, you can't put the air compressor back together. Really, other than the rebuild kit, the piston rings, the only other thing you gotta check on this thing are the bearings. And there are 2 bearings on this. One of them, you can see right down there. And if we look, this bump out on what I call the front of the crankcase is where that bearing is located. The crankshaft, one end sticks into that bearing and spins around. Depending on the vintage of compressor you have, it's either going to be a bronze bushing that has a brass color to it, or it's going to be like this one, which is the newer style, that has a roller bearing to it. And I've got one of the roller bearings right here. And if you look, you can actually see the little cylindrical rollers down in the thing. Here's the thing. If you need to replace your roller bearings or your bronze bushing, you have an option. You can either replace it with the exact same thing it had, or if your compressor has bronze bushings, you can replace them with this roller bearing. And the number on the roller bearing for this thing is a B-1212. So that right there, ignore the PB blah blah blah. That's just the manufacturer's number. It's the B-1212 is the bearing that you want. That can replace the bronze bushing, or if you want to keep it original, you can go ahead and spec out a bronze bushing for the thing. Personally, the roller bearings are much better than the bronze bushings. If yours has worn out the bronze bushings, if it was me, I'd just go get the roller bearings and be done with it. As you can see, I have a replacement roller bearing that came in this little box because the one on the flywheel side is seized up. This is the one that was in it. It doesn't turn anymore, so I got a replacement one. We'll put that in just a second. That one's easy to get out because you can actually punch it straight through. The one down here, there's no access from the back, so you can't take it out the easy way. You got to do it the slightly more difficult way. It's still pretty easy, but I'll explain how it goes. What you'd have to do to replace this bearing or bronze bushing, whichever one you have, is you're going to pack this full of wheel bearing and chassis grease, just regular generic cheap grease, comes in a little tub. You pack it full of that, and then you take a 3/4 inch round metal rod and you fit it in the center of it. It's got to be long enough that it sticks out here. Once you push it in there as far as it'll go, you take a hammer and you tap on it. What happens is that grease can't come out the back because the back is solid and grease doesn't compress. So when you hammer in, all that force is going to build up back there, and it's actually going to push this bearing out. So as you hammer the rod in, the bearing's going to work its way out a little bit. Then you'll have to stop, put some more grease in, hammer it some more, put some more grease in, and eventually it'll walk its way out. Kind of a pain in the butt for that one. My guess is you're not going to have to change that one because that one doesn't have a whole lot of load back there. The one on this end is the one that takes the brunt of the load because you've got the tension of the belt pulling it this way. You've got the weight of the cast iron pulley on it. My guess is if you do have to replace one, it's going to be the one right here, not so much the one back there. But if you do, that's how you do it. Here we have the end of the crankcase where the crankshaft sticks out and your pulley would be right about here. You can see there's the breather hole right there for the crankcase. Depending on your particular air compressor vintage, there might be a little filter for that that has essentially steel wool down in it. Other ones like this one, it's actually just a hole drilled in it to let some air in and out as the pistons go up and down. Whichever it is, the bearing part of it's going to be the same. You've got this bore right here that the bearing goes in, and this bearing wants to be flush or just a little bit recessed on the inside here. You don't want it sticking out like it is right now, and you don't want it flush with the outside, and you certainly don't want it sticking out the outside because there's a seal we have to put in there. But before we put the seal in, let's go ahead and install this bearing. Like I said previously, to get the old bearing out, it is super easy. All you have to do is take a bolt or a metal punch and just keep tapping it around and around and drive it straight out, because that's a straight bore. So if you start from the inside, tap it around and around all the way out, it'll push the seal out, it'll push the bearing out, easy to remove. It's the front one that is a bit more challenging. To put it in, what I'm going to use is a block of wood and a small ball peen hammer. Want to make sure it's started in there and doesn't look like it's crooked. Nope. I put a super thin film of oil on it just to help it go in a little bit easier. Then you want to check every now and then to make sure it's not going off at an angle. Now see, at this point, it's sticking out a little bit. We don't want that, because the end of the crankshaft right here actually rubs on this piece of cast iron right here. So we don't want it wearing on this edge, because for one thing, we're not going to be able to bolt this in all the way with that sticking out. And if it wore out this edge, there's the possibility that the needles could come out. They can't really, because they'd run into this, but it's not supposed to wear that edge. So, to get it down just below flush, I don't want to hammer on it because I don't want to dent it. If I dent this edge, these little rollers aren't going to be able to spin around in there, and I basically defeated the entire purpose of the thing. I don't care if I dent the old one, because this thing's seized up anyways. So I'm going to put the old bearing right over it and use it as a buffer. I'm just going to tap it and check. Just like that. So it's down. There's a slight bevel all the way around to help get that thing in. And I've got it so that face of the bearing is equal to the bottom of that little chamfer. So it's about a 16th of an inch below there. And we have plenty of space here to put the seal in. Speaking of the seal, you want to make sure you know before you order the rebuild kit whether you're going to have to change out the bearings or not, because the basic kit doesn't come with the seal. You'll also see there's a couple O-rings in there. Depending on what iteration of this pump you have, it may or may not use these little O-rings. In my case, this one does not use the little O-ring, so I'm just going to set them aside. Here we have the seal, and you see there's a groove on one side and it's smooth on the other. This groove wants to go towards the inside of the crankcase, so we want to put the smooth side out, groove side in, and I'm going to go ahead and put a little bit of oil on the outside of this thing just to make it a little easier to slide in. I don't want it to catch and rip on the side there. Now, if I get it started by hand, so I've got it down just a little bit, I'll take the trusty block of wood and now it's flush. So that's good. We've rebuilt this part right here, but we don't want to attach it to the crankcase yet because we need the crankshaft in the crankcase. Before we put the crankshaft back in, We want to oil this end right here, where it goes into the bearing. Doesn't have to be a lot of oil, but it just gets it so it's not starting up completely dry. This is the original bearing still in there, so it still has some oil in it, but to be on the safe side, I'm just going to squirt a little extra oil in there. Nothing bad will happen if it has a little bit of oil. By the way, the oil I'm using for this is 30 weight non-detergent oil. The kit comes with this gasket for the crankcase cover. What I want to do is put a little bit of oil on this. I don't think it's 100% necessary, but it certainly doesn't hurt anything, and it makes me feel better. Some people put silicone gasket maker on these gaskets, and you're totally free to do that, but I don't really want to, because if I ever have to take this thing apart again in the future, that's going to be kind of a pain in the butt trying to get that stuff peeled off of there. The other thing is you want to make sure you actually do have this gasket in here. Don't cheap out and think you can just put a bead of silicone on here and put these two pieces together without this gasket. This gasket is important for setting the distance between this, essentially a thrust bearing made out of the cast iron, and the thrust bearing in the front, where it sandwiches the crankshaft in there. If you remove this thickness, you've made it that much tighter, and it might be too tight and it might bind up. Even if it spins okay when it's cold, when you assemble it, when it heats up and the crankshaft expands and gets a little bit longer, it could bind up. So it was designed to have a paper gasket that thick in it. It needs to have a paper gasket that thick in it. One thing I did is I filed the end of the crankshaft so it's got a little bit of a bevel on it, because what we don't want to do is tear up this seal when I shove it on there. I also took some emery cloth and cleaned up a little bit of rust that was on here, again, so we don't rip up the seal, because as we put it on, it's going to be sliding on that sealing surface, and we don't want to rip it up right off the bat. I also deburred the edge of the keyway, again, to make sure. And finally, I'm going to go ahead and oil it up to make it slide a little easier. Finally, I'm going to load that bearing with some oil. There, I've snugged up all the bolts. I found a manual for these compressors. It doesn't have any kind of torque values on this thing, so I'm just making them tight, but not too tight. Once this thing runs for a while, I'll check these and the cylinder head bolts again to make sure they're still tight. With this done, we can set it aside and take a look at those pistons. Here's the better of the two pistons from my air compressor. As you can see, there's a lot of gunk built up in the oil ring. And by gunk, I mean actual sludge and rust. There's a lot of rust caked in there. And the top compression ring is free, but the lower ring is stuck in its groove. We look at the other one. The oil ring looks a little better on this, but both compression rings are stuck in their grooves. If you look at the sides of the pistons, they're discolored from where the cylinders sat with water in them and the cast iron rusted and it stained the side of the piston. If you look really, really closely, there are vertical score lines in these things, and the vertical score lines actually continue through the piston rings. That was my deciding factor to get new piston rings for this, the fact that they've got these vertical scores in them. I could get brand new pistons for this. And if I really, really wanted to, I could get brand new connecting rods as well. But really, for what it is, a little air compressor, the fact that these pistons are scored on the side, as long as we hone the cylinders and replace the rings, I think it's going to be just fine. It's a low speed thing. It's not like it's a lawnmower engine running at high RPMs or anything like that. For what it is, I think it'll be fine. And in the future, if these things get sloppy in the cylinder, I can always go ahead and replace them then. But for now, we're just going to replace the piston rings. I've got the connecting rod clamped in the vise, so that way the piston isn't going to go anywhere on me, because I need to remove this stuck ring. With an internal combustion engine, when it gets rings that are stuck, it's usually because of carbon buildup and just overall gunk that's solidified in there. On these air compressors, when these rings are stuck, especially on this one, it's because water got down in the cylinder. These things have rusted, and because rust takes up more space than regular cast iron, it has actually wedged itself into its groove. So it's going to be very hard to get that thing out. I could try soaking it in penetrating oil, but in reality, that's not going to loosen up that ring. I'm going to have to break it out of there. What I've found is the best tool for breaking these cast iron rings out of these grooves is this little square pointy punch. It's like a cold chisel, but instead of being beveled in just one direction, it's beveled in two different directions. So it's like a center punch, but it's square. And all I'm going to do is put the point of the punch right in the center of the ring, and I'm going to hit it with the ball peen hammer. And what I've done is hopefully crack the ring right there. I want to be careful that I don't mess up the edge of the groove. If it gets a little ding in it, I can always file it, because again, this is just a little air compressor. It's not a high precision, high speed engine. When I hammered in there, it bulged out the ring here and here because it forced that one in. So I'm going to go to one of these spots where it just forced it out, and I'm going to hammer it again. So now, what's happened, if we look, is this part of the ring has popped out. What I can do now is take a cold chisel and see if I can pop that side out, and I can. There. So the ring's going to come out in pieces. That's fine, because we're not reusing these things. And once I've got the ring started, sometimes I get lucky and I can get it to wiggle its way out the rest of the way, or it might just end up coming out in pieces. And if it comes out in pieces, that's okay too. Yep, this one's coming out in pieces. Another thing I found is if I take this cold chisel, put it in the groove, and then hit it sideways, that usually does it. So, compression rings are out. Now I gotta take the oil ring out. And because this one isn't stuck, I find the easiest way to do this is either get it to expand or it'll just break. At this point, I've got a piston that I need to go around, make sure I don't have any burrs on the edge. If I do, I'll take a little needle file and just smooth it up. I don't want to really change the shape of the piston, just smooth up any little burrs. And what I want to do is clean these grooves out, because I don't know if it shows up on camera, but there's a lot of rust and gunk down in the bottom of these grooves, and I need these things to be clean so when the new piston rings go in, they don't bottom out on gunk, because if it does, they're either not going to compress enough to go in the cylinders, or they're going to wear weird or bind up once they heat up. So I got to clean this out. One of the best tools for cleaning out piston ring grooves is a broken chunk of piston ring, which we just so happen to have. So what I'll do is put that in there, drag it around, and scrape out all the gunk. You can already see all the goo that came out of it. So I'll work my way around. I'll also take a rag and a flathead screwdriver to clean it out really well. I want these grooves to be spotless. The other nice thing about using an old piston ring to clean them out is you make sure that the groove is the right size all the way along and it's not hanging up anywhere. If you get to a point where the piston ring won't slide in the groove, that's an indication there's something wrong with that groove. You want it to be able to spin around it freely. If going after the stuck piston rings with a punch and a cold chisel freak you out because you're afraid you're going to break the piston or mangle it, the thing to keep in mind is you gotta get the stuck rings out of these things, otherwise it's no good anyways and the piston's dead. The worst thing that can happen is you mangle this thing. And if you mangle the thing, they sell replacement pistons for these compressors in the $20 to $25 range. So worst case scenario, you buy a new piston for it. Best case scenario, you don't mangle it, and you get the rings out, and you can put the rings back in. Speaking of putting the rings back in, let's take a look at the new rings. Here we have the new rings. Here we have the pile of broken old rings. The compression rings are just like the old ones. They're just standard cast iron rings, nothing special about these. One thing to note is on the inside of them, there's a bevel on one side. So this side happens to have a 90 degree edge right here on the inside. This one has a slight bevel. Same thing with this, they're identical. It doesn't matter which way you put it, which one's on top, same exact compression rings. The bevel is to aid in putting these things on. So you want to make sure the bevel goes on first, otherwise you're going to be fighting that sharp edge trying to get it down over the piston. But other than that, as long as one of these goes into each groove, you can't mess it up. The oil ring, on the other hand, is a little more complicated. If we take a look at a piece of the old oil ring, you'll see it's one piece of cast iron. It has holes in it that let the oil drain back into the sump, and it's got the two wipers on the outside, but it's all one solid piece of cast iron. That's the old style. What comes in the kit is the more modern style of oil ring, which is actually in three pieces. We've got two thin wipers. They usually come stuck together, but they are individual wipers. And then you have this accordion thing, which holds the wipers. The accordion thing, and I'm sure there's a technical name for it, but I don't remember what it is right now, so we're going to keep calling it the accordion thing, has a step in the back of it. If you look really closely, you'll see there's a little step about a 16th of an inch back from the inner edge. And if I flip it over, it's the exact same on this side as well. That step is for these rings. So the rings hit up against that step, and that's what keeps it pushed out. You got to be careful when you put these things together that these rings really are in the step and they're not slid up over it, because if you get it up over that step on one side, it takes up too much space and you're not going to get the other wiper in. So if you're having trouble getting the second wiper in the groove, it's because it's climbed up over that step. To put the accordion thing in, all we do is slide it down over, stretch it out, in it goes. Want to make sure you keep an eye on where this seam is right here, because you don't want the gap on one of the wipers to end up right where that is. Supposedly nothing bad would happen, but it makes me feel better if they're offset. So, to put the wiper on, what I'm going to do is push it into the groove and hold it there with one thumb, and then just bring it around ever so slightly. You want to be careful with these things that you don't hyperextend them. The little wiper's probably not going to break like a piston ring, but it's still not a good idea to stretch them any more than they have to be stretched. Now I've got it in between the accordion and the edge right there, and the accordion and the edge on the other side. That's not how I want it. I want it to go on this upper side only. So I can take it with my fingernail, and just like that, I now have it right there. So I've got 2/3 of the oil ring in. I want to take the final wiper. I'm going to install it the exact same way. However, I'm going to turn it so that way this gap is 180 degrees out of the way of the other gap, so you don't have them lining up. So I've got the gap in the accordion over here, 90 degrees from that. I have this gap, and 180 degrees from the wiper, I'm going to have the other gap. I'm going to do it the exact same way, hold it with my thumb, and snap it down into place just like that. So now I have the oil control ring is all set, and I can spin it freely. At that point, we can go ahead and deal with the piston rings. The piston rings you want to be careful with, because they are cast iron, so they're brittle. If you try to stretch them too much, they're just going to snap, and then you're going to have to order another one. To do this, it's the exact same thing. Hold it with one thumb and kind of work it around with the other. They do make piston ring expanders that cup the thing and you squeeze it like a pair of pliers and they open up. For this, if this is the one thing you're going to be doing, probably not worth buying a set of those just to do this. Again, want to make sure that bevel is facing down so it helps it slide over the edge of the piston. So I'm just going to stretch it, kind of work it in ever so slightly, just like that. Now, it's in the top groove. I got to repeat the process because I want to get it down in the other groove, because it's going to be impossible to get this up over this ring to get in the other groove. So all I do is start right there, kind of work it around, just like that. And then we're going to do the same thing with this. Ta-da! So now, with these grooves, or gaps, I mean, I want these things to be 180 degrees away from each other, because when these piston rings seal in the piston, they compress in, there's always going to be a slight gap here, so air's going to be able to leak past there. And if they line up like this, you're going to get a much easier path for the air to leak through than if they're 180 degrees, because if they're 180 degrees apart, it has to leak past one, leak around here, and then work its way out. So you're going to get more compression. The other thing is, you don't want these things, from a wear standpoint, lining up. Because these rings, where the cylinder walls. If you have the two gaps lined up, they're going to wear the cylinder walls everywhere except where those two gaps are. And so you're going to end up with this ridge going up and down in the cylinder wall versus everywhere else. So by keeping them offset, you're going to even out the wear on the cylinder, and you're going to get a better performing air compressor. I'm going to have these be 90 degrees to the gaps in the oil control ring. It doesn't really matter where they are right now, because they can move around until we stick them in the cylinder. So I'll arrange them right before I push them in the cylinder. I have the cylinder block clamped in the vise, and I got to be careful because it's clamping the cooling fins. If I tighten it up too much, I have a feeling I could break these cooling fins off. The problem with these cylinder blocks is the cooling fins are tapered, so there's really not a good way to hold these things in place. This is the best I've come up with so far. If you come up with a better way to hold this thing, by all means, do it. But what we need to do now is hone the cylinder, because these cylinders have a lot of scratches going up and down, and that's not good, because with the scratches going that way, we're going to lose compression, and there's a good chance oil's going to get above the piston, and we're going to be pumping oil right out of the crankcase, and that's not good, because eventually we'd run out of the oil. I've got some 3-in-1 oil. You need something to keep the metal particles that are going to get abraded off here from clogging up the stones on the hone. You don't want a real thick oil, because what it'll do is it'll actually create a film between the stones of the hone and the cylinder walls, and they're not going to rub the way they're supposed to, because they're going to be floating on the oil. I've also gone ahead and oiled the stones, and I kept oiling the stones until they stop absorbing oil, because you want the pores of the stones filled with oil, so that way the metal particles that come off the cylinder walls don't embed themselves in here. You can get cylinder hones that are different sizes. You just have to get one that covers the 2 3/4 inch diameter cylinder. Also, the stones come in different grits. For a cast iron ring, you really want the coarsest grit. At this point, what I'm going to do is start up the drill, and I'm going to work it back and forth. I'm looking for a scratch pattern in the cylinder wall that intersects at about a 45 degree angle. And when you stop, you want to pull it out in one quick motion while it's still spinning. You don't want to stop the hone in the cylinder and then drag it out, because the stones will then create the vertical scratches that we're trying to eliminate. Now that I've done that a little bit, I'm going to clean it out with a rag, and I'm going to take a look at the scratches, and I've got to go a bit more. So I'm going to take my time, just keep working at it until it looks like the cylinder walls have cleaned up pretty well. I'm never going to get rid of all the pitting and the staining. That's okay. It's an air compressor that has had water in it for years. The cylinder walls, short of reboring them, are never going to look perfect, but I just want to clean up the scratch marks. If we look right here in the cylinder that I just honed, you can kind of see that the scratches intersect each other at about a 45 degree angle. Really anywhere between 45 to 35 is okay. And being the fact that this is a hand process, it's not going to be perfect. But if you aim for 45, that's the best for a cast iron cylinder with cast iron rings. You'll also notice that there's still some pitting in here. That, unfortunately, would require boring out the cylinder, which really isn't practical, because that would cost a bit at a machine shop, and if I bored it out, the piston would no longer be the right size, so then I'd have to try and locate an oversized piston for this thing. And For a 50-year-old air compressor, I don't think that's really the best way to go about things. Now we need to attach the pistons to the crankshaft, and if we look at the connecting rod cap, you'll see there's a square edge, and then there's a rounded edge right here. It's the same way on the bottom of the connecting rod. When I took them apart, the square edges were together, so when I put it back together, I want the square edges to be together. The other thing is I want the same connecting rod to go back in its original spot on the crankshaft, because this will have worn to fit that particular spot. What I did when I took it apart is stamp two little punch marks on the side of the connecting rod and two little punch marks in on the crankshaft right next to where the connecting rod goes. So you've got two little punch marks on the lobe right here. That tells me this wants to go right here. So put the connecting rod cap down in. This is a little tricky because they don't give you a whole lot of space. But if you can hold it there long enough to get one of the bolts threaded on, that way it doesn't drop down in. And I can tip it that way. Go ahead, get this bolt in. And we want to check to make sure it turns without binding. And it does. You'll see down in here, you'll see on the top of the connecting rods, there's two holes. That's for oil. So as this thing spins around in there, this little dipper dips down into the oil in the sump and it flings it all around. Some of that oil is going to trickle down the connecting rod in there and lubricate that. What I want to do now is pre-lubricate there, so that way it doesn't start up with the connecting rod dry. And I'll just work that around a little bit. There. Now I can put that at the bottom dead center and install this one the exact same way. I can't find any torque specs on these bolts, but a 3-horsepower Briggs & Stratton engine, which has connecting rods very similar to this, calls for 150 inch-pounds. So I guess if you want to break out the torque wrench on this, I would suggest 150 inch-pounds. It's time to attempt what I think is going to be the trickiest part of this operation, and that is to get the pistons back in the cylinders. Normally, on an engine, you have the pistons go in from the head side of the cylinder, because usually the cylinder is attached permanently to the crankcase. You stick the pistons down in, and then you attach the connecting rod caps onto the crankshaft. This is totally backwards, because the cylinders themselves come off from the crankcase. You gotta have it off in order to bolt the connecting rods on. So now what I have to do is try to compress these rings and shove them up in the cylinders. Normally, you would use a piston ring compressor, which is basically a sleeve that clamps around and it smushes the rings down into their grooves, and you can then use that to help you get it in the cylinder. I can't use one here because it would be trapped in this thing. You got to be able to slide it off somehow. So what I'm going to attempt to do is push the rings together. There's a bevel on the bottom of the cylinders, so I'm hoping that because these are small rings and they're fairly easy to smush, that I'll be able to smush them one at a time and get them in there. Oh yeah, that's not bad at all. Of course, now that I've got that one started, I gotta get this piston started as well. Again, the biggest thing is we don't want to break the brand new piston rings. Here's one. Now, there we go. I've got it down to where this oil ring is in. This one is partially in. So let's see. If I can swivel it a little bit. There. Now both oil rings are in. There we go. And we just want to make sure that gasket is still lined up. And it is. There. Those are in, and I believe that is the trickiest part of this entire operation. Let's set this aside and back away slowly from it and work on the heads. It's time to deal with the reed valves on this compressor. This iteration of compressor has what I'm calling a valve block, which is this piece of metal that has the two outlet reed valves in it, and this gets sandwiched in between the head and the cylinder. On some iterations of these compressors, they don't have this individual valve block. They've got the inlet and the exhaust valves in the head. And you can tell that head because there's a rectangular opening here with a metal plate over it where the air comes out, and it'll have two individual foam air cleaners on it instead of this one big rectangular felt one right here. From the factory, these reed valves are held in with little bolts that take a 3/16 socket. Now, the problem is not only are they tiny bolts, they're also a very low profile head. So a regular socket, because it's rounded a little bit, has a really hard time grabbing onto these heads. It's not that they're rounded over, it's just they don't stick into the hex part of the socket. To fix that, what I'm going to do is take this cheap socket and I'm actually going to file it down to get rid of this rounded over section. Now with it filed down, it grabs the bolt just fine. Okay, it's time to put the reed valves in, and the rebuild kit comes with a whole bunch of things that are like reed valves. It comes with four thick reed valves that are about twice the thickness of the four thinner reed valves. Then it comes with these two things that are even thicker, and they have a slight bend in them. These are the restrictor plates for the exhaust valves. With reed valves, if you just had the reed valve attached with two screws, when the piston came up, there'd be so much force with the air blowing out, lifting these up, that they would lift up too far, and fairly quickly they'd break right there because they're flexing too much. On the intake side, it doesn't do that because of how this thing's built. This opening right here that mates up with the reed valve for the intake acts as the restrictor plate. The way it's shaped, this reed can only open so far on the intake stroke. On the exhaust stroke over here, there's nothing like that. So you need to have the restrictor plate there. So it goes reed valve, then restrictor plate, and that limits the opening and it makes the valve last a lot longer. Speaking of the reed valves, I mentioned there were thick reed valves and there are thin reed valves. From everything I could find online with old manuals for these compressors, the thick reed valves are used on the air compressors that have the one-piece head, that don't have this valve block to them. You can tell it from this one because, for one thing, it doesn't have the valve block, but also those ones seem to have four intake valves. So there's two intake valves per cylinder on that head. And from what I can tell from the parts diagram, one of those intake valves is a thin one per cylinder, and one is a thick one per cylinder, and then the two exhaust valves on that pump are both the thick valves. On this style with the valve block, from what I can tell, they are all the thin valves, and that's what was in here originally, so that's what I'm going to put back in. So I take one of the thin reed valves, I take one of the restrictor plates, I put it on like that, and then I'm going to use these new Phillips head screws that came in the kit instead of fighting with the little bolts. One final thing I want to do is I want to put a little bit of Loctite on these things. To be perfectly honest, I'm not sure how effective the Loctite's going to be on these because these heads run pretty hot, and I'm not sure at what temperature this Loctite stops being effective, but I want to give it a shot because these have a tendency to loosen up over time and get sucked down into the cylinder. In fact, one of the pistons on this one, on the top, you can clearly see where it pounded one of these little bolts into submission at some point, because it's got indentations all over it that are shaped just like one of the intake bolts. So I'm trying to have it not do that in the future. And then I want to go ahead and tighten those down. So I've installed the intake reed valves, and if we look, they're not actually sitting right on the seat there. They're up about a 32nd of an inch. In reality, this probably isn't a big deal, because as soon as the piston starts going up the cylinder, it's going to create air pressure, and that's going to push these things closed. So I'm not too worried about that. But just to show you what we can do to fix that, I'm going to unscrew this one. And if I put in the vise just beyond where the screw heads go, and I bend it just a little bit, just like that. So now it's got a little bit of a bend. Now when I go ahead and install it, it'll be nice and tight. Finally, it's time to put on this gasket. These rectangular cutouts are for the intake valves. This big weird cutout is for the outlet valves. Put that like that, then we put the head on. Now it's time to put the bolts in and try and line this whole thing up, because we've got the head, the valve block, the cylinder block, and then the crankcase all have to line up. The compressor's already built. It would be really tempting to slap this thing on the air compressor, belt it up, and see what it does. But there's a couple things we need to do with this newly rebuilt air compressor before we can have it start building air pressure. First, most of these pumps have these multi-V pulleys. It's like a serpentine belt in a car. It's a flat belt with a whole bunch of V's on the bottom instead of just one big V-belt. They did that because they're running a very small pulley on the motor, and regular V-belts don't like to go around very small pulleys. They don't get a lot of grip to them, and they tend to wear out due to the intense bending. Because of that, they went to the flat belt with the multi-ribs to give it enough friction to actually drive the thing. It's a good belt system, but there's a limitation. It is very picky on alignment. The grooves in this pulley have to be perfectly aligned with the grooves in the motor pulley. Otherwise, it'll jump the tracks. In fact, I can see evidence here where they rubbed on both sides of this pulley. If it does that for too long, it's going to destroy the V's on the bottom of the belt, and then it's worthless. You got to buy a new one. So when you put the compressor on the tank, my suggestion is put all four bolts in, snug one up, just snug, keep the other three loose. That way you can twist it a little bit to line it up parallel with the pulley. Once it's lined up parallel with the motor pulley, you can leave this set screw loose and slide this in and out to get it perfectly aligned. So it's got to be parallel like this, and it's got to be in the same orientation front and back. Once it's lined up perfectly and you've turned it by hand a few times to make sure it's not jumping the tracks, go ahead, tighten the bolts down, test it one more time, because sometimes these things shift a little bit as you tighten them to the mounting plate. At that point, it is really, really tempting to connect up the airline to the tank and start building air pressure, but you don't want to do that. Both this manual and this manual say when you first buy your air compressor, or in this case, we've just rebuilt it, so it's essentially a new air compressor on the inside, you want to run it with zero air pressure for half an hour. What that does is it breaks in the rings, because right now the rings have jagged edges on them. You can't see it, but they're there on a microscopic level, and the cylinders have jagged edges because we just honed it and it put scratches in it. We need those two surfaces to wear together so it gets a good seal and it lasts a really long time. If we don't get it to break in properly, we're going to be right back here rebuilding it way sooner than we would otherwise. So it's a good idea, once it's belted up correctly, turn on the motor, let this thing just pump air to nowhere for half an hour, and then what I would recommend is change the oil. The oil is cheap compared to the time it takes to rebuild this whole thing. And as this thing's breaking in, as the piston rings are going up and down, they're going to be wearing the sharp edges off the rings, the sharp edges off the cylinders. That's all dropping down into the oil sump. We want to clean that out. So belt it up correctly, run it for half an hour with no load on it, change the oil, plumb it up, and it should be good to go for another 50 years. Speaking of oil, there's a lot of confusion on the oil to use on these things, and for good reason. Sears was not real consistent with their recommendation of oil over the years. This manual from the 70s, which this pump looks a lot like this one, clearly calls out using 10W40 detergent oil. That's right, not non-detergent oil, regular detergent motor oil that you put in a vehicle. That goes against the internet's wisdom of always using non-detergent oil with these things. This one, basically the same pump. This is a one head piece design instead of the head and the valve block, but essentially the exact same pump. This one, on the other hand, clearly calls for 30 weight in the summertime and 20 weight in the wintertime. So straight oils, and they don't say detergent or non-detergent. I'm going to guess non-detergent was implied, because the 20 weight oil, I find that straight 20 weight oil is always non-detergent oil used for lubricating things like electric motors, stuff like that. But it doesn't say one way or the other. I've also seen an air compressor just like this with the silver pulley and the red compressor and a red tank that had a sticker on the side that called out 10W30 detergent oil. So it seems like for these, detergent, non-detergent, they couldn't make up their mind at the factory, therefore I wouldn't overthink it. From what I've heard, the detergent oil, if there's a downside to it, it's that the additives in it will cause carbon to build up more on the reed valves than non-detergent oil. That's about it. There's a lot of talk about it, keeping stuff in suspension, not in suspension, blah, blah, blah. It's a little air compressor. It's a little non-precision air compressor. I really don't think it cares. they don't seem to care in the manual and the stickers they put on the side of it. So if they're not going to overthink it at the factory, we probably don't need to overthink it. If it makes you sleep better at night, put non-detergent 30 weight oil in it, call it good. If you're going to be running it in the cold and you really have something against detergent oil in this thing, use 20 weight non-detergent oil. If you really don't care one way or the other, use 10W30 or 10W40. I really don't think it's going to matter. The only thing it's going to hurt, possibly, is the reed valves are going to clog up sooner. But if it is, just unbolt it, clean the reed valves. Pretty easy. So, that is the rebuilding of one of these twin cylinder air compressor pumps. Not that hard, really don't need any specialty tools other than a cylinder home.